Hello, I'm James Turner, one of 3D engineers at KDAB. Continuing our series on 3D solutions in Qt6, I'd like to talk to you today about the integrated solutions which are available in Qt6 to help you get 3D content on the screen. Obviously, the first thing we need to talk about is what I mean by an integrated solution and what particular features that would imply compared to other ways you might integrate 3D. The key things we're concerned about in a solution for 3D in Qt6 are that it uses the rendering hardware interface, which is the new abstraction for different underlying graphics APIs on different platforms, which is available, which is used by QtQuick. This is also because we want to be able to integrate our 3D content with our 2D content provided by QtQuick, hopefully in seamless ways where we can layer 2D content on top of 3D, underneath 3D, and potentially including 2D content on surfaces in our 3D. A good example of this is when you want to have a 3D model of perhaps a car, but then use an existing 2D quick interface on the dashboard, but still be able to view that car in 3D, including those virtual screens. Following on from that, we want to ideally use QML for our scene compositions, if we're already familiar with QML, and use all the expressive power of bindings, animations, and integration with C++ objects to retrieve data. Of course, it'd be great if being a part of Qt, all our existing familiarity with resources, deployment, IO devices, networking also worked as standard. And going one even further than that, one of the pieces that Qt manages well is debugging and deploying on different devices. And it would be especially good if to deploy our 3D assets, textures, and models, that all our normal deployment features were pretty much as expected with Qt. As you can maybe tell from the pieces I'm highlighting, these are all areas that can be a big problem if they're not considered, and which can be a hurdle of integrating a third-party rendering solution into Qt. Let's start with the most obvious solution, which is QtQuick 3D. It's also worth mentioning at this point that there are a variety of solutions here. The naming does get a little bit confusing, so I'll try to be really clear about which solution I'm talking about. This is QtQuick 3D, which is the new solution for 3D content added in Qt 5.15, and which is the out-of-the-box solution in Qt6. QtQuick 3D is the most straightforward solution for Qt6. It's a modern renderer targeting the common features needed, particularly on embedded Qt applications, to get modern 3D content into your application in a straightforward way. It implements what we call a PBR renderer, a physically based renderer, and the rendering algorithm is a particular strategy known as Forward Plus, which can support lighting, shadows, and other effects in a way that looks pretty standard and modern for a 3D engine these days. It's more advanced than what would be called a traditional Phong renderer, which can't handle dynamic lighting shadows very easily. And QtQuick 3D supports loading GLTF2 assets and a rather complete range of the features GLTF2 can contain, which means animations, including skinning animations, particles, image-based lighting, reflections, and more. Like QtQuick, QtQuick 3D is extensible via some C++ APIs to define custom types of meshes, instancing, and some other pieces, but it doesn't have a complete C++ API the way some other technologies do. The most important piece when starting out with QtQuick 3D is its QML interface and how it integrates. QtQuick 3D provides a scene view type, which is a 2D component, and within that scene view, your entire 3D scene resides. So the scene view is a 2D element like an image or a movie that can be anchored and layered with your other 2D content. And within the scene view, you define a 3D scene with meshes, lights, materials, whatever the pieces you have, and that's drawn by a camera associated with the scene view. More complex arrangements are possible with multiple scene views sharing the same scene, multiple cameras, but the standard configuration of a scene with a camera that's shown in that 2D viewport is working out of the box with the scene view. Because it is QML, all our standard QtQuick and QML techniques can be used, as I mentioned, so bindings, animations, passing properties down, mouse areas, and input interacting with the 3D scene all works pretty much as you'd expect. As well as defining your entire scene in QML, which might be simple for a small scene but get more cumbersome, you can load scenes from GLT2F assets and indeed a few other asset types as well. loading in a GLTF scene or collection object is very common. So it's obviously you don't want to define too many details of a 3D scene inside QML if you can help it. The renderer in QtQuick 3D is a forward plus renderer implementing physically based rendering, very commonly referred to as PBR. Here we get some examples of this, which gives very pleasing, realistic reflections, surface texture, and some other features, especially shadows. Crucially, as well as the basic PBR, this supports some very commonly used features, especially image-based lighting, which is a very efficient way to make scenes look much more realistic by modeling the environment the scene exists in, using images as a light source. This means you can model an outside room or perhaps a showroom with floodlights in the ceiling and have that light be accurately picked up by the model and appear in reflections and highlights in other areas. As well as the PBR support, the renderer supports HDR, high definition rendering or high dynamic range rendering. This allows for capturing a much wider range of tonal values, very light and very dark scenes, often needed for modeling outdoor scenes with bright sunlight and deep shadows. And it supports the feature called tone mapping, just how that large range of lighting values map down to the usually 8-bit values supported by your LCD display. This tone mapping can achieve different effects, make things look more dramatic, more cinematic, or perhaps more stylized for particular kinds of highlighting and industrial application where you want to show certain areas more clearly in the scene. Basic rendering algorithm is fixed in C++ to ensure it gives excellent performance on smaller devices, while still allowing hook points and extensions to be defined in C++ plugins or in QML. QtQuick 3D has a lot of advantages, but it also has some choices which are made in its design, which are give us some restrictions and drawbacks. The major one is that, like QtQuick, the C++ API for QtQuick 3D is restricted to only certain extension points. You can't create a full scene or fully define what you want to do in QtQuick 3D using C++. You're forced to use QML most of the time. Like QtQuick, there are some slightly interesting techniques can be used to actually get full control of a scene in C++, but they're taking advantage of the meta object system in Qt, and the primary intention is to use QML largely with small amounts of C++ to define your scene. This works for some applications, but for certain data processing, CAD, maybe scientific areas, this might not be a good match for what you want to define. The next decision we've made in QtQuick 3D is to make it a single-threaded renderer that runs synchronously with the 2D Quick renderer and with QML updating. This makes complete sense for keeping the architecture simple, and again, is a good match for single-core embedded devices, but it means there's no ability to take advantage of multi-core desktop CPUs, or for example, quad-core embedded CPUs to improve rendering performance and rendering throughput. Again, the goal of QtQuick 3D is not to make a 60 FPS or 120 FPS game renderer with, you know, tens of thousands of objects to support a small, well-defined scene, usually on a limited device. Finally, the rendering algorithm is predefined in C++. This again means it can be very well optimized, but it means that if you find a particular different rendering technique, for example, support accurate transparency layers, there's a technique called depth peeling, or if you have a scene with a very large number of perhaps lights or certain shadowing characteristics where you want to use, for example, something like a deferred renderer, this cannot be done using QtQuick 3D because the rendering algorithm has already been decided for you. The forward plus renderer does support many common appearances, so it's a good obvious choice for a fixed renderer, but it's the one you're going to be using if you use QtQuick 3D. So that's QtQuick 3D, and now we're going to talk about Qt3D, which is the renderer introduced in Qt5, which has some quite different characteristics. Qt3D is a completely extensible data-driven renderer, not just the scene graph, the hierarchy of things we're going to see and view and move around in our 3D world, but also the frame graph are defined by data. You can use QML or C++ to define how rendering occurs, the number of passes, the intermediate frame buffers, the format of those things, the shaders they use each step to build up the complete frame in arbitrary complexity, even potentially going as far as, you know, 10, 15, 20 render passes if you want to do something very complicated with different intermediate steps for lighting, surface appearance, shadows, bump mapping, and so on. There is, of course, a default renderer, which is also a forward plus renderer. And this is available out of the box to avoid too much other work for you when using Qt3D. The next big difference is that Qt3D is built on an entity component system, which is standard in many game engines and makes it easy to compose complex scenes with many entities, with many different pieces of functionality being included or skipped for performance reasons, and scalable to large numbers of objects. But it does need to be considered as a little bit of a different thing from the simple tree structure that QtQuick and QtQuick3D use. Finally, there was an explicit design goal in Qt3D to enable full C++ and QML interface parity. Every single thing can be done from either language or both, and you can freely mix the two together. So if you wish to avoid QML scripting in your application, you can define a full scene in C++ based on whatever I/O source and files you wish, without having to do any mapping to QML to build up your scene. Let's think about the entity component system a little bit more. This is, again, is a standard concept where functionality is defined by small reusable components, and a piece of functionality is typically grouped by its area. So, for example, in managing audio in a 3D world, you might have sound sources, things which receive sound, might be called listener, maybe some things which reflect sound in particular ways, and so forth. Each of these is a component, and many objects in the scene or the world might not produce sounds. Most presumably won't hear sounds, but a few will. And those entities would have those particular components attached to them. This is also true for maybe some of them have a position or an animation attached to them. Perhaps in a rigid body simulation, some objects have mass, some objects don't, because they're simply like a UI element or a billboard for whatever reason. All these different components are composed together by you into entities. The behavior of the system emerges from the interaction of those components that you've created together into entities. It's a very common one to do with, for example, creating light, or give us a specifying the material appearance of something in the 3D world, or its geometric structure. So the rendering aspect, as it's called, of Q3D processes all these things relating to appearance, shading, light, and combine to give you a rendered scene. Part of the goal of this is that the processing to do with each aspect and with the end components can happen in worker threads. So the entity component system is a part of allowing us to use threading and multi-core CPUs quite intensively in Qt3D. That actually gives very good performance on desktop machines, but the doing so helps you have some overhead on smaller devices. So this kind of gives us an idea of some of the drawbacks of Qt3D. You have to work with the entity component system, which is powerful, but a little bit more complex than the simple tree structure in QtQuick and Q3D. The multi-threading features of the component system are very good fit for a games console or desktop PC, but on smaller devices, especially single embedded devices, which have a higher rate of threading, it has some drawbacks. All the flexibility of being able to define a frame graph from data is lovely, but it does give you more things to configure out of the box, even though there's considerable work in Qt3D to define prefab pieces and a default forward renderer, default materials, and so forth. There is still some more configuration work. One final thing to consider is that Qt3D was written in the Qt5 timeframe, when QtQuick always used OpenGL as its underlying GPU abstraction. And Qt6 is no longer true. We have the rendering hardware interface we'll talk about in the follow-up video. And Qt3D is being ported to use this interface, but right now we're still in a moving from a OpenGL worldview to using RHI. This means depending on which features you need, some of them may not work the same on the RHI backend for Qt3D as they do using the OpenGL backend. Hopefully that's given you a good idea of what Qt3D and Qt3D can do, where they both excel and where there's some trade-offs between the two. In the end, probably what you would do is start validating the feature set you need in your renderer, and if it mapped to Qt3D, it's probably the right choice for a new project. But if your scene is very large, you need particular control from C++, or you want to do a radically different rendering technique, you'd want to consider this seriously if you could do that by customizing either at the extension points or even at the source code level Qt3D, or whether Qt3D with its more open customization might make sense. Again, assuming that its rendering features and other areas matched your hardware, and assuming your hardware has the performance characteristics around threading to support what you want to achieve. Finally, you might think I've forgotten a solution here, and I kind of have, but I've left it to the end. There's a third option integrated into Qt for producing 3D content, and that's Qt3D Studio. Qt3D Studio is a legacy third-party solution which was integrated into Qt during its lifetime in the Qt5 timeframe. It's a very focused, comparatively simple renderer, still with support for shaders, reflections, and so forth, but considerably simpler than the other two renders we discussed. This feature set means it has it's less visual appearance, but the performance characteristics are very predictable, and they're a very good match for potentially much older embedded systems going back maybe even 8 or 10 years with much more controlled performance characteristics, which might be important in industrial control, automotive, and certain embedded applications. To use Qt3D Studio, you define your scenes in a custom scene format, not a standard one, using a custom editing tool, which is rather similar to PowerPoint in defining a range of slides which can be swapped between each other, and each of which contains the 3D content. You attach behaviors to these, including animations, but once you've loaded your scene into your Qt application, you have rather limited control from QML and C++. There is some control, but it's a little bit awkward to go and get data in and out. Taking all these things together, it's very unlikely in this year that this is what platform you want to build a new 3D product on top of. It's mostly there to support legacy customers and maybe serve an example of some ideas, but probably not a technology to build for in the future. So that's our overview of the integrated solutions for 3D in Qt6. We're going to look in more detail in a future video about how the rendering hardware interface works in Qt6. Because if you wish to include a third-party solution beyond these three, that's what we're going to have to deal with to work on different platforms and integrate. This used to be a simple job because the only answer was we use OpenGL, but now that situation is very complex. We're going to talk about it in much more detail. I hope this explanation of the 3D technologies built into Qt has been interesting. And of course, like most things to do with Qt, there's a whole range of examples that ship with the Qt installer, which will let you try out these features and evaluate them for yourself, both on your computer and also on embedded targets, and see if they're going to fit what your needs for your applications.